Good morning, and happy 4th of July. I thought today would be a good time for us to think about what it means to be American and how music makes that happen. I'm not interested in patriotic music. I remember this one song I learned in school. It went something like this. I like the United States of America. I like the way we all live without fear. I like to vote for my choice, speak my mind, raise my voice. Yes, I like it here. Yeah, I was only in junior high school at that time. And my sense of politics at that point was rather vague, but I knew that was not the America that I could see outside my window. So one of the pieces that I do want to talk about today is one that I happen to like quite a bit. It's the one that was performed just before this sermon, which is Aaron Copland's Fanfare for the Common Man. Now, Aaron Copland is often considered to be America's composer, with his famous evocations of American life in pieces like Billy the Kid, and Rodeo, and Lincoln Portrait, and Appalachian Spring. Of course, he did not fit many stereotypes that people would have had for being an American composer. For one thing, he was a Jewish kid from Brooklyn, something that wouldn't count against him today, but did count against him in the 1930s. He was also gay. Not until his death in 1990 did the fact that he was gay come out. He was also a leftist, not exactly a card-carrying communist, but close, especially in the early 1930s when he was part of a composer's collective, or in 1934 when he won first prize in a contest for the best protest song for May Day, and he wrote a tune called Into the Streets, May 1st. It's not a tune you get to hear very often, but you can hear it here, as I'll show you on YouTube.
Into the streets, May 1st, into the roaring square, shake the Midtown towers, crash the downtown air, come with a storm of banners.
Copland muted his ideology as he became more famous in the late 30s and early 1940s, but even Fanfare for the Common Man has a political edge. It's 1942. World War II has just started. Eugene Goossens, the conductor of the Cincinnati Symphony, commissioned a series of fanfares to be played at the beginning of an evening's program. And there were a lot of composers who contributed. There was a fanfare for the Medical Corps, a fanfare for the Fighting French, a fanfare for the paratroopers, a fanfare for the Merchant Marine. Copland looked for a way for his piece to stand out, and he was inspired by a recent speech by then Vice President Henry Wallace called The Century of the Common Man. Wallace was defiantly leftist. In fact, that's one reason he was dumped from the vice presidential slot in favor of Harry Truman in 1944. And Wallace was casting World War II as yet another moment in the ongoing struggle between the slave and free worlds. He saw it as a struggle that started with the American Revolution in 1776, also the French Revolution, and continued through the Russian Revolution in 1917. As he put it, this struggle has not yet been completed either here in the U.S. or any place else in the world. Some have spoken of the American century, he said. I say that the century into which we are entering, the century which will come into being after the war, can and must be the century of the common man. So that angle, the common man, meant the peace was meant not only in support of what America was fighting for, but for what it could be around the world. And you can hear some of this same spirit in many of Copland's great pieces from the 1940s. It has made Copland an ideal sonic symbol for Americanism in movie soundtracks. I don't know if you saw way back in 1998 Spike Lee's movie He Got Game, a movie about basketball, but one that Spike Lee decided needed only one kind of music in the soundtrack, and that was Aaron Copland. In fact, let's watch the beginning of the film, and what you'll hear behind all these images is perhaps a lesser-known Copland piece, but still a great one, based on the African-American ballad John Henry. Another clip where you can see a playground basketball game being underscored by a musical Americanism in the form of Copland's Hoedown.
Come on, wait. Check out Brogdon.
Who got next?
I'm a bitch. Hey, yo, we got next.
That's it.
Kick these motherfuckers' ass.
Come on, shut up.
For real.
Play ball. I'm big man.
Flex on that kid, man.
By yourself, man. Let's go, baby.
That's all.
Break.
Let's go, G.
Hey. Get on that.
Boy, by yourself.
Yeah, come on. Get
him. Light him up. Lock him.
Oh, you got nothing?
Oh, shit.
I got
come
it.
Back. Come on.
We got it. Right
back at him. I'm open.
Now, you may not think of basketball when you hear Aaron Copland's evocation of folk fiddling in Hoedown, but part of what I want to talk about today is how modern Black Americans can take something like Copland that seems to evoke America and use it for their own version of what they think America is. But before I do that, I do want to backtrack a bit and talk about Black American music itself as a symbol of America. This idea has been around for a long time. In fact, it can go back to the 1840s and the minstrel show. That's a form of theater in which white Americans wore blackface while performing their own version of African-American folk music on fiddle and banjo and bones and tambourine. For all its obvious flaws, the minstrel show dominated the American musical stage throughout the 19th century. And that's just part of the story. Beginning in 1871, the Fisk Jubilee Singers brought African-American spirituals to concert audiences both here and abroad. And a few decades later, Antonin Dvorak was invited to this country to serve as the head of the National Conservatory of Music, and he listened to spirituals, sung in this case by the great baritone Harry Burley. And in 1893, he declared that, quote, "the future of music in this country must be founded on what are called Negro melodies. These beautiful songs are the product of the soil. They are American, and your composers must turn to them." And he demonstrated this in his New World Symphony, where the slow movement began with his own black spiritual, now probably better known as Going Home. So let's listen briefly to hear Yo-Yo Ma performing this for us all at the beginning of the pandemic. As much as I admire Dvorak's statement and his musical creation, I think that there's more to Black American music than beautiful melody. What Black Americans accomplished is more like a new way of creating music, a new musical grammar derived from Africa. I'm going to play you an example that goes back about as far as I can manage. The recording dates from the 1960s, but the group, the Georgia Sea Island Singers, was founded in the 1930s. On these coastal islands off of Georgia, slaves brought directly from rice-growing Africa worked on the rice and cotton plantations, and during the summer, when white residents fled inland to avoid malaria, there were only a few white overseers left in charge. And after emancipation, these former slaves, known as gullahs, were left to eke out a living on their own. The result was a culture rich in African tradition, isolated from the mainland by swamps and salt marshes. So listen to this tune. led by singer Bessie Jones, called the Buzzard Lope. And in this video, you're going to see the dancer imitating a buzzard, ultimately snatching a bit of carrion in the form of a white claw.
So me anywhere, Lord, in that old field. 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 Don't care where you throw me, in that old field. Left gang people throw me, in that old field.
So what's the first thing that you noticed? Probably call and response. It's a practice that's widespread throughout the world, and it has both social and musical functions. It isolates the musical leaders, in this case people like Bessie Jones, who provide the call, but it links them to the rest of the community, who are expected to provide the unchanging response. And there is no audience in this. Just participants. There's also what I call a cyclic structure, a repeating pattern that goes on for two bars or four bars, depending on how you count it, over and over and over again. But that structure allows for what could be called rhythmic contrast. In African cultures, there are always at least two sharply contrasting rhythmic layers going on at the same time. Some of them are fixed, some of them are variable. And the fixed is fairly easy to hear and to feel. Those steady foot pats, the hand claps, which fall not on the beat, but off the beat. That sense of backbeat adds to the multidimensional quality of the rhythm. And you may sense a more subtle polyrhythmic feeling. There's a pattern that's sort of like dunk, 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 dunk. Something that I learned in West African drumming, but the kind of thing, call me, throw me anywhere, Lord, in that old field. Throw me anywhere, Lord, in that old field. All of this adds to the polyrhythmic quality of what's going on. And let me add one more thing that came from, I learned from my African-American composer, Ollie Wilson, who was my thesis advisor. He called it the tendency to fill up musical space. And maybe I ought to make it less passive and just say, people are expected to fill up the musical space. Why? Because it's expected of them. It's as if, you know, if you go into a black church, you know that people respond to what you say. And if this were a black church, you'd be going, mm-hmm. So it's not a group thing. Each individual feels the responsibility to put in their own response at a time that feels right to them. It's as if they've been taught, it'll be your turn soon. Get ready. And when it is your turn, don't be shy. Let's hear it. So this totality, the open-ended cyclic structure, the use of rhythmic contrast, call and response, which means everyone is involved, means there's room for everybody's response. And finally, there's also this sense of resistance. We've been saying for some time now, Black Lives Matter, but we know that that's just a polite way of saying, stop killing black folks. This song, Throw Me Anywhere, is really referring to the grim reality that sometimes happened on the Sea Islands, which is that slaves were often not buried, but left to the buzzards. And as the text shows, Christianity is part of the answer. It's the supernatural power of King Jesus that will protect them under the most horrific circumstances. But it's also the power of community and the power of black music. So with that in mind, let's return to the idea I raised back with Spike Lee that modern black artists can take music that's not their own, but make it their own. So, it's the summer of 2008 in Denver, Colorado. Actually, 2 days before Barack Obama is about to arrive in town to accept the nomination for president at the Democratic Convention. The mayor of Denver is about to present his annual State of the City address. And a jazz singer named Renee Marie, misidentified here as Renee Martin, is asked to open the ceremony.
Renee Martin to sing our national anthem.
Lift every voice and sing till earth and heaven ring. Ring with a harmony of liberty. Let our rejoicings rise high as the listening skies. Let it resound loud as the roar. Dark past has taught us. Sing a song full of hope that the present has brought us. Facing the rising sun of a new day.
From that video, she did sing the melody for the Star Spangled Banner, but the words are from the Negro National Anthem, Lift Every Voice and Sing. I talked with her about that this week. She let me know how she was feeling in that moment.
I mean, I was really so scared at the mayor's State of the City address that day. And up until I sang the first note, my brain was still saying, you can get out of this. You don't have to sing it your way. You can sing it the traditional way.
Right.
And it was scary. Seems like all of my, some of my best decisions are always preceded by a lot of fear. A lot of fear. And then the fear goes away after about 4 seconds.
She later provided a more lengthy description of what happened after that performance.
So the first project was The Voice of My Beautiful Country, which is the suite of America the Beautiful, My Country Tis of Thee, Lift Every Voice and Sing, and The Star Spangled Banner. And I wanted to take those songs and rewrite them to reflect what it's like being a female of color in this country. The songs in themselves are already beautiful. You know, the melodies have always made me misty-eyed and, you know, feeling all sentimental and stuff. But, you know, music is a real personal thing. And I think the composers of those songs did a great job, but it's not the music that I grew up the way I grew up hearing music. Well, you know, I was surrounded by gospel, blues, jazz, you know, that type of thing. And I thought, you know, I'm an American. These are American songs. Why can't I take the melodies and redo them, keep the lyrics, but change the melody up to reflect my background and my upbringing? It's true, not everybody was pleased with that. I was surprised by that at first. Not that they were not pleased with it, because I know everybody's taste is different. People not gonna like everything you do. But I was surprised at the level of anger that accompanied it.
Lift every voice and sing till earth and heaven ring with a harmony of liberty.
The anonymity of the internet allowed them to say exactly what they were feeling and thinking.
High as the
I thought, wow, all these people that are emailing me and calling me on the phone, they're all Americans. And I'm getting to hear what these strangers think and feel about this music, about races, about Obama, about me. Some of it was in-your-face anger, nigga, nigga, nigga. Some of it was total confusion, like, well, why did you do that? And some of it was like, go ahead, girl. So it ran the gamut of responses, and I loved it. I loved it. I loved it.
I've taken up enough of your time on this glorious 4th of July, but I hope all this gives you at least something to think about as we all contemplate what it means to be American. May we all be equal to the challenge.